الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وبه نستعين، ونصلي ونسلم على أفضل الخلق أجمعين، نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وبعد. We commence by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sending blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his entire household, and all his companions. May Allah bless them and may He bless every single one of us. Beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving us this opportunity to engage in prayer and in salah in this month of Ramadan, and to be fasting for His sake, abstaining from food and drink and permissible sexual desires, and at the same time all this for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whilst being conscious of what we utter during the daylight and the night of the month of Ramadan, in a way that not only will we be able to achieve the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but we will be able to exit this month of Ramadan in a manner that we become better people than we were before the month. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us benefit. Yesterday we had commenced the battle of Badr, the first major battle that took place between the kuffar of Quraysh and the Muslims from Madinatul Munawwara. And we had made mention of some very, very important points, the run-up to the battle, as well as the beginning, the starting point of the battle. I'd like to just recap very briefly. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam had a little command center built for him known as Al-Arish. And as I said, up to today, if you were to go to Badr, you would find a masjid in the place where this command center was. And he had instructed the believers with instructions that people had not yet witnessed before that particular war. One of those instructions was that they were to make lines, literally stand in rows, just like our rows when we stand up for prayer and salah. And thereafter, those who were with bows and arrows had to be in the front. Those who were with swords had to be behind. And as you know, they were only two horsemen from amongst them. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them, look, we had not intended to have this war, but seeing that we are going to fight, we need to be careful how many spears and arrows we use. We don't even have so many. And as for the kuffar, they were very excited. They had been partying the whole evening. And there is a narration, very clear cut, authentic narration, that makes mention of the fact that Shaytan came to them. And Shaytan told them on that day of Badr that you will not lose. I am with you and I am the one who's going to help you, and so on. So in what form did Shaytan come? In the form of a man known as Suraqah bin Malik. I'm sure you've heard the name before. If you recall, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam was making the hijrah, this Suraqah bin Malik, Shaytan used to come in his form. More than once he has come in the form of this man. May Allah protect us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. We don't want the devils coming in our forms. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us, inshallah, the protection against the devil at all times. So Shaytan came and Shaytan promised them that, look, I am with you. You will definitely win. There is no chance that those people can win. And then when the two armies had finally clashed, Shaytan saw the angels, Jibreel and Mikael. The angels were from amongst those who had come down in their thousands by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's will and instruction, and Shaytan ran away. They actually saw the Suraqah bin Malik go away. Abu Jahl tells him, where are you going? He says, no, I am going. And he began to run. They tried to get hold of him, they couldn't. He ran away. And this is mentioned in the Quran. There is a verse. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
وَلَا تَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ خَرَجُوا مِنْ دِيَارِهِمْ بَطَرًا وَرِئَاءَ النَّاسِ وَيَصُدُّونَ عَن سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ والله بما يعملون محيط.
Don't be like those who came out of their homes in pride, haughtiness, arrogance, in order to lead astray from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah knows exactly what they were doing. So Allah is instructing not only the Muslimin at the time, but all of us as well. We should abstain from pride and haughtiness, and we should not be from amongst those who lead people astray from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The very next verse, Allah says,
وَإِذْ زَيَّنَ لَهُمُ الشَّيْطَانُ أَعْمَالَهُمْ وَقَالَ لَا غَالِبَ لَكُمُ الْيَوْمَ مِنَ النَّاسِ وَإِنِّي جَارٌ لَكُمْ.
And remember when Shaytan beautified for them, when Shaytan beautified for them and told them that I am going to be by your side. He beautified their deeds, and he beautified their effort and their work, and he told them, don't worry, you will never lose, I am right by your side. Then the verse continues, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
فَلَمَّا تَرَاءَتِ الْفِئَتَانِ نَكَصَ عَلَىٰ عَقِبَيْهِ.
When the two armies finally clashed, Shaytan ran away. He turned his back and he was gone.
وَقَالَ إِنِّي بَرِيءٌ مِّنْكُمْ.
And he told them, I am free from you. I am disassociating myself from you.
إِنِّي أَرَى مَا لَا تَرَوْنَ إِنِّي أَخَافُ اللَّهِ.
I see that which you don't see, which means the angels. I am witnessing, I can see the angels. I see that which you do not see. And I fear Allah.
وَاللَّهُ شَدِيدُ الْعِقَابِ.
Allah is indeed very severe when it comes to punishing. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. From this, we need to pause for a moment and look into our own lives. This is Shaytan's plan. He helps a person to engage in wrong and makes him falsely feel that he's doing the right thing. Until when that person has got to a point, Shaytan then runs away and leaves him in the lurch. Let me give you an example. A gambler. A gambler will continue gambling, thinking I'm making more, I'm making more. Shaytan is by his side in the form of women, in the form of men, in the form of people giving money, in the form of borrowings and so on. Don't worry, you're going to win, you're going to win. And he starts winning one, two, three. When the large amount is about to be lost, Shaytan is gone. When you lose it, he's not there to help you. And then he is completely in disappearance. May Allah protect us. The same applies to adultery. A person is prodded, everything seems to be nice, everything is, you know, seemingly rosy. Shaytan goes and beautify everything. And thereafter, when the act is committed and now people are caught red-handed, Shaytan is gone. He doesn't help you out of your mess. Remember that. Shaytan's job is to get you into a mess. Once you are in it, he's out. So a winner is the one who understands the plot of Shaytan and does not allow himself or herself to fall into that plot in the first place. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. This is the plot of Shaytan in the battle of Badr. This is what he did to the mushrikeen. He made them feel they were doing the right thing. They were going out, and he was encouraging them to do this and to party and to do that. When it came to the war itself, he ran away. And he says, look, I fear Allah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. These are verses in the Quran. As we had said, they had the duel. We want to quickly mention the names of the three from amongst the mushriks who had come forth, and the three from amongst the believers who had come forth in order to engage in the sword fight, which usually commenced the war. What would happen? They would bring out the best of their warriors, and these would engage in one-on-one fighting. And once that came to an end, the armies would then clash. This was like a prelude, and it was meant to infuriate the party who may have lost lives in that particular duel. So Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib came out from the believers. Together with him, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu came out, and Ubaidah ibn al-Harith radiallahu anhu came out. These three were out, and on the other side, the one who faced Hamza was Shaybah ibn Rabi'ah. And the one who faced Ubaidah ibn al-Harith, his name was Utbah ibn Rabi'ah. And the one who faced Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, he was the son Al-Walid ibn Utbah, the son of Utbah ibn Rabi'ah. And Hamza radiallahu anhu struck his opponent, the opponent was executed. Ali radiallahu anhu in no time struck his opponent, the opponent was executed. But Ubaidah ibn al-Harith radiallahu anh, there was quite a bit of a fight that ensued between the two of them. And what happened? One struck the other struck this one. And Ubaidah had been quite injured. And at the same time, this man was also, Utbah, was injured, until Hamza and Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhuma, they came to the assistance of their man, of the Sahabi, Ubaidah ibn al-Harith, and they helped him. And this is when all three of the mushriks were there slain. And this infuriated Abu Jahl. And they became angry. Their leaders were gone. They were so angry, they charged forth for the Muslimin who were given instruction not to move. They were standing in their rows. As they are charging, they were instructed by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to fire when they had come very close, when the enemy came very close. And so those with the arrows released those arrows. Those with the spears released the spears. And this resulted in many of those mushriks losing their lives. And thereafter, you find as they progressed further, they were instructed to fire again. And by this time, the horsemen had already started coming. And a lot of the horses were attacked. They were harmed. And you know, when a horse is hurt, and when one drops, the others that are with it, they are confused. They want to turn back. Some of them drop themselves as well. So a lot of chaos was caused. And thereafter, these people, the two armies had clashed, and this is when another instruction came for those with the swords to remove their swords and begin the fight. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. These were brave people. We can even say that the mushriks of Makkah were brave enough to face the Muslims one-on-one. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. Allah says, there are those who are coward, very cowardly, full of cowardice, who will fight you from behind the walls. They won't come and attack you one-on-one. They will fight you from behind fortified walls and so on. But these were not the mushriks of Makkah. They had chosen to come and fight bravely. But at the same time, they started losing. And we want to make mention of a few of the people who had lost their lives from amongst the mushriks of Makkah. Firstly, their leader was Abu Jahl. Abu Jahl had people around him. And he was at a certain point where nobody could reach. The minute someone would go there, they would be tackled by someone. Because he was the leader of the army. Unlike the Muslims, this leader of the mushriks was far behind. He was being protected. So Abdurrahman ibn Auf radiallahu anhu makes mention in a hadith, which is also authentic, mashallah. It is reported in Sahih al-Bukhari as well. There is a whole chapter, the chapter of the execution of Abu Jahl. And this is where some of the narrations are made mention of. And Abdurrahman ibn Auf radiallahu anhu says there were two young boys from the Ansar, young boys. One was Mu'adh ibn Afra radiallahu anhu, and the other one was Mu'adh ibn Amr ibn al-Jamuh radiallahu anhu. The two of them, young boys, came to me, he says, and they told me, uncle, literally that word, uncle, who is Abu Jahl? So Abdurrahman ibn Auf says, I looked at him and I said, what do you want with Abu Jahl? He's the leader of this army here. What do you want with him? No, we've heard that he swears Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We've heard that he has caused much suffering to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Today we want to sort him out. Subhanallah, young boys. Now had these people been older, they would not have been able to cross the lines and the ranks of the mushriks, because their leader was heavily protected. But because they were young, they got away with it. What happened is Abdurrahman ibn Auf says, after some time I saw Abu Jahl and I showed them. I say, there's the man. Don't worry, I'm not pointing at anyone here. We're pointing at the wall there, inshallah. So there he is, and he shows them. They were so happy. He says, no sooner did I say this than they had already got to him. And what they had done, they got him off his little horse and they had started striking him. And the people around didn't even notice that these two were attacking. Besides the son of Abu Jahl, Ikrimah ibn Abi Jahl, he struck one of them quite badly. In fact, he struck Mu'adh ibn Amr ibn al-Jamuh to the degree that one narration says he lost part of his hand. But by this time, the youngster had already struck Abu Jahl, who was on the ground, and he was already almost complete, almost finished. He was just making a bit of noise this way, that way, breathing heavily, and he had already had bodily injuries that were quite severe. And in no time, the other youngster comes. And when he came in, Mu'adh ibn Afra, he had struck Abu Jahl and ensured that now there is no movement of this particular man. He was still breathing, but there was no movement. This was the leader of the Meccan army, taken on by two little boys from the Ansar, subhanallah. And as for Mu'adh ibn Afra, in that particular battle, he was martyred. He had fought and fought. Young boy, he fought so much, and he was martyred by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as for the other Mu'adh, he had lived on quite long, even after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu says, after that battle, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked a question, where is this Abu Jahl? Who can go and see what has happened to him? And Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu says, when I went there, he was breathing his last. Abu Jahl was breathing his last. And there was a discussion between them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from arrogance. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had seen this man Abu Jahl executed, he declared the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That was one of the biggest enemies of Islam. So much so that one narration says that he was the Fir'aun of this ummah. He was the Pharaoh of this ummah. If you look at the Pharaoh of Musa alayhi salatu wa sallam, when he had arrived at the point of his death, what did he say?
La ilaha illa alladhi amanat bihi banu Israel wa ana min al-muslimin.
Fir'aun says, the Pharaoh says, there is none worthy of worship besides the one whom Banu Israel are worshipping. The God of Musa, the God of Moses, may peace be upon him. That's the one I believe in. But it was too late. Allah says,
الآن وقد عصيت قبل وكنت من المفسدين.
Is it now that you want to turn, and yet you had been so full of transgression in the past? Allahu Akbar. And you were from amongst the corrupt. It was too late. He had seen the angels of death. But he was better than Abu Jahl, because Abu Jahl on his deathbed uttered words of blasphemy instead of turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So imagine, when a person is now on his deathbed, instead of uttering words of goodness, he utters bad words. So this was Abu Jahl, and this is how he had actually been brought to an end. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from all tyrants. The other man who was one of the leaders of Quraysh, we've heard already of Utbah ibn Rabi'ah and those who took part in the duel who had been executed. One of the people who was a leader was Umayyah ibn Khalaf. The same Abdurrahman ibn Auf says, I was a friend of Umayyah during our days in Mecca. I was a businessman, he was a businessman, and we had an understanding of protecting our interests. Until when I came to Medina Munawwara, initially there was an understanding between us that you would protect my interests in Mecca and I will protect your interests in Medina. So Abdurrahman ibn Auf felt that he needed to show this man that I am here to protect you. But at the same time, Abdurrahman ibn Auf was within the army of the Muslims. And what happened? Bilal ibn Rabah, when he saw Umayyah ibn Khalaf, it brought back all the memories. The memories of how he was tortured by this man. The man had taken him out into the heat of the desert and pulled him on the rocks of the hot Sahara desert. And at the same time, he had placed hot boulders over him on his chest, and he was whipping him. He made him bleed, and he continued saying, go back and leave Muhammad. Stop saying one. Stop saying one. Ahadun ahad was the word that Bilal ibn Rabah was saying. For your information, during the wars, they normally had what is called a war cry. I'm sure you know the meaning of a war cry. So the mushriks had their own statements they used to utter. The Muslims had powerful short words that they used to constantly repeat. It is reported in the narrations of the historians that the word repeated in the Battle of Badr was Ahadun Ahad. The same words that Bilal ibn Rabah was saying when he was being harmed by Umayyah ibn Khalaf. And they heard Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam uttering other words. You know what he said? He kept on repeating, سَيُهْزَمُ الْجَمْعُ وَيُوَلُّونَ الدُّبُرُ سَيُهْزَمُ الْجَمْعُ وَيُوَلُّونَ الدُّبُرُ. It's a verse of the Quran. But he was repeating it, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It means this group of people will be overcome. They are going to lose and they're going to run away. They're going to flee. Subhanallah. They're going to run away. So this, he kept on repeating it, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as for Bilal ibn Rabah, when he saw Umayyah ibn Khalaf, he told himself, I am not safe and I will not be saved if this man is saved today. So the Ansar, some of the people of Medina Munawwara who had heard the story, they knew what happened to Bilal ibn Rabah. Some of them gathered with him and they started chasing. When they started chasing this man, Abdurrahman ibn Auf went to him and tried to protect him, in the sense that tried to give him a little bit of shelter and cover, because this was the understanding between them. And Bilal ibn Rabah radiallahu anhu, as this man was instructed to stop by Abdurrahman ibn Auf, stop, don't worry, get off your horse, get off. And as he got off, Abdurrahman ibn Auf covers him. And as he is covered, Bilal ibn Rabah and the members of the Ansar strike him from beneath Abdurrahman ibn Auf. They strike him and they get rid of him, subhanallah. They strike him, they injure him, and he begins to bleed. And at the same time, Bilal ibn Rabah was so thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving him a day of revenge and retaliation. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. Remember, people might think that this sounds gruesome. It sounds awesome. It sounds gruesome. At the same time, we need to understand, these people were criminals. They were people who had perpetrated crimes against humanity. They had executed so many innocent people, stolen their wealth, and they were actively engaged in military activity against the Muslims. And at the same time, if you look at them, it was them who wanted to fight in Badr, not the Muslims. The Muslims had come out for something else. Abu Jahl was the one who insisted, because Shaitan made him feel that today you're going to win. He is the one who insisted, we want to fight these Muslims no matter what. So this was something Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran. وَلَوْ تَوَاعَدْتُمْ لَاخْتَلَفْتُمْ فِي الْمِيعَادِ وَلَكِنْ لِيَقْضِيَ اللَّهُ أَمْرًا كَانَ مَفْعُولًا لِيَهْلِكَ مَنْ هَلَكَ عَنْ بَيِّنَةٍ وَيَحْيَى مَنْ حَيَّ عَنْ بَيِّنَةٍ. Allahu Akbar. Powerful verses of the Quran. Allah says, if you, the two armies, had made an appointed time to fight, perhaps you wouldn't have clashed. You wouldn't have met. This was planned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says, Allah intended for that which was made to come to pass, to come to pass. So this was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's plan. He says, to destroy those who were destroyed upon evidence. They knew what was right and wrong, they were destroyed. And to allow those who won and who lived to live with evidence, upon evidence, they knew that we are on the right path. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to understand his plan and to follow it at all times and not to follow the plan of shaitan. When the war was over, 70 of the disbelievers had lost their lives. 70. And they were approximately between 900 and 1,000 when they had now arrived in Badr. We explained when they left Makkah, they were a little bit more in number. But when they got to Badr, they were less, because of the letter that Abu Sufyan had written to say, you may now go back. And some of the clans went back and some of the people went back. So they had lost 70 of their lives. And 70 of their men were taken prisoner of war. They were taken captive. And from amongst the believers, 14 men were martyred. Subhanallah. Look at the figures. These were only 313, they're going back with 299, subhanallah. And those, the rest of them fled, they ran away. And they had a silly system. Their system was, when we go out for war, we take with us a lot of our jewelry and a lot of our wealth and a lot of this and a lot of that. So they had come with a lot of their wealth and jewelry and a lot of their belongings and merchandise and so on. And do you know what? They ran away. When they ran away and they left everything on that battlefield, subhanallah, the Muslims, this was their ghanima. Ghanima meaning it was the spoils of war. One might call it booty. It was that which was left behind by the kuffar as they fled. And this is why the Muslims were instructed, they began to gather the items that were left behind by the mushrikeen. So they had lost 14 lives. the Muslims. 14 of them were martyred, 6 from amongst the Muhajirin and 8 from amongst the Ansar. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam immediately sent 2 men to Medina Munawwara to inform them of what happened. And this was the good news that got to Medina Munawwara, but it was bad news for some people. We'll explain who. Who were the two who were sent? Abdullah ibn Rawaha radiallahu anhu and Zayd ibn Haritha. They were sent back to Al-Madina Al-Munawwara with the news. So when the news got to Medina Munawwara, the Muslims were so happy, so excited. They knew, they said, Allah has fulfilled His promise to us and Allah has granted us victory. And they could not believe that the same people who had persecuted them and executed or murdered some of them were now themselves executed. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us victory upon victory. What happened? They were very happy, delighted. At the same time, the people of the book, the people of Banu Qaynuqa', Banu Nadir, Banu Qurayza, they were upset. And the hypocrites, Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, they were upset. Why were they angry? They were not expecting the Muslims to win. They were hoping that the messenger be executed, everyone be executed, Quraysh can win, and we can now be the leaders once again of Medina Munawwara. So they were very upset. They were so angry that they started planning and plotting. And they became very loud-mouthed and said, you people went out only because you wanted to get the spoils and you wanted this and you were greedy and so on. Statements that were flying around undercover. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exposes these people. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knew them. And what had happened, as the messengers came back, when the Muslims saw the captives, this is when they knew something has happened here. Imagine the power that Islam and the Muslims had achieved by conquering the superpower of the time, who was Quraysh, with a meager force, small force. And this is mentioned in all the books of Seerah. They returned to Al-Madinah Al-Munawwara with 70 of their men, minus 2. Why minus 2? Meaning 70 of the captives. 2 of them, they were court-martialed on the way back by the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They were found to be criminals who had perpetrated crimes against humanity and they were executed there and then. Who were they? Uqbah ibn Abi Mu'ayt, one of them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us and may He grant us goodness. And An-Nadr ibn al-Harith, he was the other one. These were the ones who had harassed and hassled not only the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam personally, they were guilty of war crimes and they were the ones who had persecuted and executed people in Makkah al-Mukarramah. So they were court-martialed. Court-martialed meaning they were not just killed for no reason. They were found guilty of crimes against humanity and they were executed. These were the two. The rest of them came back and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made an announcement. Be careful how you treat the prisoners of war. They are human beings just like you. You should feed them. You should clothe them. You should not harm them. You should provide for them shelter. You should ensure that you treat them in a humane way. All this is recorded in the books, not only of hadith, but the books of history. These are the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The first nation that ever granted rights to prisoners of war was the nation of the Muslims. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the first man who treated the prisoners of war as human beings who were granted 2 meals a day. Subhanallah. And at that time, they barely ate a meal a day. Subhanallah. They were respected. In fact, there is a certain one of them who was very bad mouth against the Muslims when he was in Makkah al-Mukarramah. He was from amongst the prisoners of war. His name was Suhail ibn Amr. He was so eloquent, he used to give lectures against the Muslims. So Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu saw him and said, O Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, let me fist this man one and break all his teeth. He won't be able to talk after today. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, I have been sent as a mercy. These are prisoners of war. We have never been taught to harm them and we are not taught to remove their organs or even their teeth. May Allah protect us. Not to be harmed. This is a lesson. Islam has taught us justice even during war. It's the only religion that has such upright teachings that even during war, we are just. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. This was the war, the first major battle. People were learning. The mushriks were learning because they were prisoners of war, watching what was going on. None of them was maltreated. And they knew why 2 of their people were executed. They knew that they deserved that. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then, subhanallah, after having instructed his companions, regarding these captives, he then asks them, what should we do with these people? We have options. One of the options is, we can execute, court-martial them one after the other and see who is guilty and see what we want to do, execute them one after the other. And the other is, perhaps we can accept a ransom from them, meaning making them pay a fine for fighting against the Muslims. That's basically what it was. People call it different terms. We can choose to call it what we like. What is meant by it is what is more important. So what is the meaning of it is, we will make them pay a fine for having taken part in the war against us, and then when they have paid that amount, we can free them. This was known as al-fida. They were supposed to pay an amount. So Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu says, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, these are the enemies. They're going to go back, regroup, come back and fight us again. What's the point of releasing them? We'd rather do what the other option was. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Umar ibn al-Khattab was quite a tough man. Sa'd ibn Mu'adh radiallahu anhu shared his opinion. He says, oh, you know, I wished that we didn't have people who were captive that we would take back. Sa'd ibn Mu'adh was from the Aus in Medina Munawwara. And as for Abu Bakr and the majority of the Sahaba, they told Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, these people, they seem to be remorseful. You can accept from them some form of an amount or the fine, and thereafter you can release them one after the other as you feel correct. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then agreed regarding the rest of the army, besides the two who were already executed according to the statement of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, the rest of the army, he agreed, we will put a tag for every single one of them depending on their financial condition, and thereafter we will release them one after the other. So those who were very poor, they were instructed to do something else. Those who were extremely wealthy, they paid the maximum amount. So it's not like people who were more wealthy had to pay more. No, there was a maximum amount, then there were literally discounts for some people, which means some people who were kind to the Muslimin in the past, who had looked after, who had had a few good habits and qualities in the past, they were treated slightly more leniently because of the goodness of the past. So from amongst these, we'd like to make mention of some of these people. Firstly, the story of Amr ibn Abi Sufyan. Abu Sufyan's son was one of those who was caught. And Abu Sufyan was told that they are asking for X amount and they will free him. He says, I will never ever allow my son and my wealth to go to the Muslims, not both of them. We will sort this out in another way. And when one of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, whose name was Sa'd ibn al-Nu'man al-Ansari, when he had gone for Umrah, he was quietly in Makkah al-Mukarramah, Abu Sufyan got hold of him and sent a message to Medina Munawwara, release my son and I release this man. Look at him, intelligent man. We said he was extremely intelligent, Abu Sufyan. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam heard the news and he released this man, because obviously it was worth the Muslim being released from captivity there in Makkah al-Mukarramah, and this is how the son of Abu Sufyan was released. Then we have a very, very touching story. Abu al-As ibn al-Rabi'a, he was the husband of the daughter of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whose name was Zainab. So he was the son-in-law of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And in Mecca, he did not accept Islam. His daughter was a Muslimah. She had accepted Islam. She wanted to come out for Hijrah. He blocked her. He said, you're not going anywhere. So she was one of those who could not make the Hijrah. She was stuck in Mecca. Her husband was a very good man, because Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that this Al-As ibn al-Rabi', we've never had a problem with him. He has honored my daughter, he's looked after her so well, and he is not a bad man besides the fact that he's a mushrik. He has not accepted Islam. But now the difficulty was, he came with the army in order to fight. There were some people who came to fight because they couldn't remain behind in Mecca, they had to show face. So Abu al-As ibn al-Rabi', he came to Al-Badr, to Medina Munawwara, close to Medina Badr, and he came to fight. Now that he was captive, he was told, you need to pay this amount. So he sends message to his family in Makkah al-Mukarramah, made up of the daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when the amount came, he was instructed to pay a certain amount. When it came in the form of a necklace, a gold necklace. And this gold necklace was the same necklace that the wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was the mother of Zainab binti Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Khadija binti Khuwaylid, had given her daughter the day she got married. This is a gift for you, my daughter. You're getting married to this Al-As ibn al-Rabi'. Take this and carry on. So when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw that the ransom that has come for this Al-As ibn al-Rabi', who is my son-in-law, is made up of a gold chain which was given to my daughter by my wife, radiyallahu anhum jami'an, Allah be pleased with all of them. Immediately he told his companions, look my companions, I want to ask you, if you feel fit to return this piece of jewelry to Zainab, then you can do so. The reason is, she is a Muslimah and she is paying from her own wealth. And obviously this is something that was given as a gift to her by one of the women who was the closest to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's heart. And still, he did not just make a decision. He's telling the Sahaba, look, if you feel that this is correct, we can do this. So they agreed that yes, it is correct. Subhanallah, subhanallah. And they returned Abul As with the piece of jewelry on one condition. What was the condition? The condition was, you go to Mecca and you allow my daughter to make the hijrah to Medina Munawwara. Don't block her anymore. So he agreed. When he went there, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had sent some people to collect his daughter, Zainab binti Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and she had then come to Madinatul Munawwara. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us an understanding. That Al-As ibn al-Rabi', he did not accept Islam immediately, but when he accepted Islam, just before the victory of Mecca, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam returned his daughter to Al-As ibn al-Rabi' without any new nikah. He said, this is still your wife and you can take her back. This was the instruction of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, although it happened many years later, but he returned the wife to the husband. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. This was the honor of the man who was kind to the family members of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Another man who was from amongst the captives was Al-Walid ibn al-Walid, the brother of Khalid ibn al-Walid. His name was Al-Walid ibn al-Walid. They sent message to Khalid, you need to pay the amount. Khalid paid the amount. Al-Walid ibn al-Walid went back to Mecca, accepted Islam there, and after some time came to Medina Munawwara. They asked him, why did you accept Islam after you came back? You should have just told him you want to accept Islam. His response was, I did not want them to think that I am entering Islam because I am frightened and I am scared. Sometimes people might think that this man entered Islam because he was frightened, he was scared. So he says, I wanted to sort the matter out, but Islam is the religion. He saw how the captives were being treated, what happened in war, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's justice, how the captives were honored by those who had captured them. Even though they themselves may not have had enough, they still gave a lot to these people. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. Another man who was amongst those who was caught on that day as a prisoner of war was Wahb ibn Umayr al-Jumahi. His father was a friend of Safwan ibn Umayyah, Amr al-Jumahi. And Safwan ibn Umayyah, what he did, he was speaking to this man, Umayr al-Jumahi, and he says to him, Umayr al-Jumahi, he says, you know what? Umayr says, if I didn't have so many children and if I didn't have so many people to look after and this and that, I would have gone and I would have executed Muhammad myself and I would have taken my child and come back. So Safwan ibn Umayyah told him, they were in the house, just the two of them. He says, look, I'll look after your family. I'll pay all your debts. I'll look after all your affairs. You go and do what you said you want to do. The man said, okay. And he took his sword and he went to Medina. Imagine nowadays people talk big, but when it comes to action, they run away. This man, he spoke very big. When it came to action, he said, okay, and he went away. So Safwan ibn Umayyah had promised to look after the family and so on. when this Umayr al-Jumahi got to Medina Munawwara with his sword, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu saw him with a few people and he says, this man intends harm. So he caught him and brought him to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, leave him, release him, let me talk to him. He says, oh Umayr al-Jumahi, why are you here? He says, I am here for the captain. He said, but why did you bring a sword? Why are you here? Are you sure this is what it is? He says, no, I'm sure this is what it is. The Prophet ﷺ told him, no, Allah has informed me. You sat with Safwan ibn Umayyah in his house, and this was the discussion. And then you picked your sword up after he had said he will look after your affairs and your family, and you came to Medina Munawwara. This man was shocked. He said, wallahi, I have heard that you're a fortune teller, you're a magician, you are this, you are that. But this had happened in a way that nobody had seen it besides me and Safwan, and I bear witness you are the messenger of Allah, and I bear witness that there is none worthy of worship besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He accepted Islam. Look at how he had come in with the bad intention and he accepted Islam, and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam released his son as well. The two of them went back to Makkah to al-Mukarramah. They did not allow him to leave Makkah thereafter to come back. And he had to come very quietly. He came actually just before one of the battles. In fact, the time of Umratul Qadha, he had escaped to Medina Munawwara, the same man. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant them mercy. Another man, very interesting, the uncle of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Two of his uncles were caught. They had come out. Now Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told some of his companions that if you see Al-Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib, who is my uncle, don't kill him because he has come here being forced to come because of circumstances. But he didn't want to fight us. He was the one who helped them to migrate to Medina. He helped them strike the deal with the Ansar and so on in Mina. So this was the man. When he came, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw him, Al-Abbas ibn Abd al-Muttalib, from amongst the captives. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw as well Aqil ibn Abd al-Muttalib, another uncle of his. And he says, you people need to pay the ransom. But you want us to pay ransom, we are related to you. No, you pay the ransom. If you are not going to pay the amount, nothing we can do. So Al-Abbas ibn Abd al-Muttalib tells his nephew, oh my nephew, you are going to make me poor. If I pay this amount that you are asking for, 100 uqiyah, which was a large amount, I will have nothing. And I'm going to be poor, I have nothing. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, you are telling a lie. Before you left for the war, you spoke to your wife Ummul Fadl, and you gave her a large sum. And you told her, I'm giving this to you because if I die, at least you can be wealthy. What about that sum? He said, who told you about that? It was a secret between me and her. Nobody knows about it. He says, Allah informed me. Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a deep understanding. Al-Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib did not accept Islam at the time, but the amount had come in. He paid 100 uqiyah, and his brother Aqil ibn Abdul Muttalib paid 80 uqiyah, and they had got the wealth that came in from Makkah to make that payment. He accepted Islam just before the victory of Makkah. That's when Al-Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib came to Medina Munawwara with his family. When the mushriks of Makkah were deciding what to do with the believers, he decided, let's leave. He met the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam on the path. He joined the Muslims and he said, look, I bear witness, it's about time I came. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a deeper understanding. Another very, very interesting story is that of Abu Azza al-Jumahi. He came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he says, O Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I have nothing, no wealth, I have many children, they are in need of me. I came with the army, I fought you, and now I feel that I need to go back. I need to look after my people and my family and so on. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam studied his case. As we said, some of them were released without any payment because they were poor. This was one of them. He was released and he was told, okay, go back, you can go back to your people and so on. The man's name was Abu Azza al-Jumahi, and he was the one who the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had forgiven. And now when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to Medina Munawwara, many of the people started entering the fold of Islam. Some of them, like Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, they entered it because they saw the Muslims were mighty and powerful, and they had seen that there is no way out. So now came the role of hypocrites. They were people who pretended to be Muslim and they were not. But the reason why they did it was to serve their own interests. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us and grant us goodness. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. I want to make mention of something very, very powerful. Very powerful. What was the rank of the people who took part in the battle of Badr? It's important for us to know. They were from that day on known as Al-Badri. So after the name, you have a little title called Al-Badri. So if you hear Abu Mas'ud Al-Badri, it means that person took part in the battle of Badr. He has a status higher than the others. When they came to Medina Munawwara, there were some people who had not taken part in the war because they were given duties by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Some of them, one of them in particular, was granted the title of a person who took part in the battle of Badr, and his name was Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu. He was married, very interestingly, to the daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who was divorced from the son of Abu Lahab. Ruqayya radiallahu anha, she was married to Uthman ibn Affan after she was divorced from the son of Abu Lahab. Because when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam in Mecca had started spreading Islam, Abu Lahab told his sons, two of them were married to two of the daughters of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Ruqayya and Kulthum. So Abu Lahab told them, divorce these two and send them back home. That's exactly what they did. This is my enemy, send them home. So these mushriks of Mecca, they had divorced the two daughters. Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu married one. Just after the battle of Badr, she lost her life, Ruqayya binti Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And this was also a very sad day because Uthman ibn Affan was told not to take part in the battle because he needed to look after his wife. His wife passed away, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam told him, don't worry, you marry the other daughter of mine. Her name was Kulthum. And this is why he is called Uthman the Nurain. He had married the two Noors, the two points of light, which means two of the daughters of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they were both married to Uthman ibn Affan, Uthman ibn Nurayn, radiyallahu anhum jami'an. May Allah be pleased with all of them. As for Al-As ibn al-Rabi'a, we said he was married to Zainab binti Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Abu Lahab went to him and told him, my two sons have divorced the two daughters of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You also go and divorce Zainab, the daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Do you know what he said in Mecca in the early days? And this is one of the things that was remembered the day he was granted freedom from captivity. He said to Abu Lahab, you can do what you want. I'm not going to divorce this wife of mine. I love her and she is one of the best of the women. And if you were to give me any one of the women of Quraysh in her place, I would never release her. They wouldn't be able to do justice to her level. So he really loved his wife. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought him just before Yawmul Fath, the day when the victory of Makkah happened and the wife and husband were united once again as Muslimin. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a deep understanding. So we were making mention of a Badri. Badri being a person who took part in the battle of Badr. But at some stage later on, when the Muslims were preparing to conquer Makkah, to march onto Makkah many years later, one of the people who took part in the battle of Badr made a mistake. What was his mistake? He was worried because there were thousands of Muslims preparing to march onto Makkah, and he had some interests in Makkah and members who were members of his family. He wrote a letter for them and he sent it. He sent it quietly to say, this is what is the plan of the Muslims. His name was Hatib ibn Abi Balta'ah radiallahu anhu. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all a high rank. Hatib ibn Abi Balta'ah made a mistake. He wrote this letter, and Allah had informed Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they intercepted the letter at a certain point. Inshallah, we'll get to that when we discuss that battle. And thereafter, some of the Sahaba got up and they wanted to execute Hatib. They told Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, can we beat this hypocrite? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, what are you talking about? Do you know he took part in the battle of Badr? وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ لَعَلَّ اللَّهَ اطَّلَعَ عَلَىٰ أَهْلِ بَدْرٍ فَقَالَ اِعْمَلُوا مَا شِئْتُمْ فَإِنِّي قَدْ غَفَرْتُ لَكُمْ. How do you know? Allah looked at the hearts of the people who took part in the battle of Badr and told them, do as you please from this day, I have forgiven you completely. Subhanallah. That was the rank of the people of Badr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, he looked at their hearts on that day And he told them, do as you please, I have forgiven you. Subhanallah. And this is why Hatib was excused. The Prophet ﷺ did not punish him at all. Later on, the same Hatib, someone spoke about Hatib ibn Abi Balta'ah. And the Prophet ﷺ says, how can you say he is a hypocrite when he took part not only in Badr, but even in Hudaybiyah? Allahu Akbar. Even in Hudaybiyah he took part. Don't call him a hypocrite. And this is why the Prophet ﷺ says, لَا تَسُبُّوا أَصْحَابِي فَوَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ لَوْ أَنْفَقَ أَحَدُكُمْ مِثْلَ أُحُدٍ ذَهَبًا مَا بَلَغَ مُدَّ أَحَدِهِمْ وَلَا نَصِيفَهُ. Don't ever speak bad about those companions of mine. Don't speak bad about my companions. Because I swear by Allah, if you had to spend gold worth the Mount Uhud, gold worth the Mount of Uhud, it would never ever equate even one hand that they had spent, or even half of their handful. Theirs was much more in value than whatever you can do. So don't ever talk bad about the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, not a single one of them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us love for the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam got to Medina Munawwara, something else happened there. There was a lot of noise being made by some of the people of the book, Banu Qaynuqa in particular, and some of the hypocrites. They were trying to harm Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's the unity of the Muslims. They were trying to harm it, and they had broken the treaty that they had with the Muslims in a few ways. One of them was as follows. In the marketplace of Banu Qaynuqa, one of the Muslim women was sitting. And she had covered herself completely. And one of the people of Banu Qaynuqa, mockingly, as she was sitting, he sewed the bottom of her dress to the top of her dress. And he put a stitch and he carried on quietly whilst she did not notice. So because she was sitting, she didn't know what had happened. When she got up, part of her leg showed. When part of her leg showed, they laughed at her. Because now it was stuck. When that happened, some of the Muslims got up and they attacked the man who did it. And sadly, it resulted in his death. When that happened, some of the people of Banu Qaynuqa got up and they started fighting with the Muslims. News got to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that this is what they did to one believing woman. And inshallah, tomorrow we will see how he retaliated sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Until we meet again, we say wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad. Subhanallahi wa bihamdihi, subhanaka allahumma wa bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.
Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin, ar-rahmanir rahim, maliki yawmiddin, iyyaka na'budu.